type of disobedience or fear or something like that that he needs to overcome. And at some point, he may just all of a sudden be like the one who said no, and then all of a sudden, he repents, and then he's out in the field doing the Father's work, you know? But that has absolutely nothing to do with unpardonable sin, I don't think.
Right. Yeah, and I don't know where, I don't know where he's coming from.
Yeah.
Yes.
And if that is it, which you may never know, but if it is, you might tell him, because you know him. He's out talking to everybody about Jesus. He talks to all the neighbors. He may not be preaching from a pulpit, but he's preaching on the streets.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So.
Here's your sign.
Did he refer to this scripture?
No. No, but I will. Because it had been so long since I've run across this. This was an awakening for me. And I made notes, go, next time you're down at Jimmy's house. Mm-hmm. So it's flagged. And it will be coming up during the next conversation. But I think Brian put it very eloquently, kind of surprising, when he said, I can see that as a type of disobedience, but not an unpardonable sin. And also, because then I got into this with him, it's not like it was a contested discussion, but I shared the story with you know about Amy, and when her Baptist preacher, said that, your grandmother is not in heaven because she's not a Baptist. And Amy said, well, then you and your God can go to hell. Well, I asked my neighbor. Now, this was a long time ago. She since, doesn't feel that way. My buddy down the street said, during times of personal tragedy, he said, I have damned God, and I have damned Jesus Christ because of the loss that our family has suffered. And that's not, although I don't think that's appropriate, but that's just me. I have heard, stories about people doing that in times of, tremendous grief and tragedy in their family. But luckily, he experienced, God's forgiveness, because when we take a look again at the first half of verse 31, and so I tell you, every kind of sin and slander can be forgiven. And boy, is he thankful for that. He says, because there was a period of time when me and God weren't on speaking terms, especially after I lit into him like I did. Yes.
Look at these guys that, and I saw it a lot in the 70s, these guys that used to try to prove their point that God isn't existent, in the fact that they would stand out in public and curse him and say, okay, if you really are there, hit me with lightning, prove yourself, And he said, come on, kill me right now, And he forgives that. I mean, he we don't know where that guy is. I mean, right now he may be a preacher, But I saw that in the 70s where they would just curse God. And yet that isn't blasphemy. It's just the fact that they were so ignorant, of God, that they have no clue. They don't even realize what they're doing, because they don't know God, And in not knowing God, you act a fool. We all do.
Carla, does this remind you of the internet joke?
No, this reminds me of the 70s, and any of us that lived through it are lucky to be here.
I'm sure you've all seen it or read it on the internet, where the college professor is down there on the stage, and this is one of those amphitheater kind of things. And he did the same thing. It's a joke. But he's saying the same thing. He's standing there on the stage. Here's all these college students. And he's saying, if there's a God, let him kill me now, because I don't believe in a God. And I'm going to wait here until he strikes me dead. Well, just a few seconds later, the guy that just got out of the service walks up on the stage, walks up to him, and cold cocks him. I said, what'd you do that for? God's busy, so I'm taking his place.
So, Brandon.
I've always looked at it kind of like this, you know, it's really a condition of your heart. You blaspheme with your heart and soul before you do with your mouth. And when a person gets to the point of where they're so self-centered and self-minded that they have no use for a God whatsoever at all, and the scripture talked about it in certain spots where they reach such a coldness that they're just turned completely over, that's the beginning of blasphemy, where you just say, I want, not that I don't want nothing to do with them, but you basically just give up the whole concept and idea of a God completely, and you'll never change your mind. You become so set in stone that you know, you just get turned over to your own devices. And I think that at that point, a lot of people, they get to a point where their heart turns completely to stone, and it will never change. And they deny the power of God completely. And the Holy Spirit is our resurrection. You know, he's the resurrection and the life. Comes through Jesus, but the power of the Holy Spirit. Once they completely 100% deny and say, and say within themselves, I will never accept this, then really you blaspheme from within, and eventually it's going to come on the outside.
I've wondered about what Dennis has said about a discharged Marine that walked in. He was talking about the flags. I think about Gail's husband, who was in Africa for I don't know how long, and they both have said, you know, if you had seen the atrocities that I have seen, you would know there was no God. Because how could God allow this to happen? And when it comes to, I think it's Gail's husband, you know, when he was talking about, I've seen people come in, you know, it'd be like a Boko Haram type group come into a village and with their swords or machetes, you know, cut the babies in half and then just watch them drain out into the ground and stuff like that. He said, if you've seen stuff like this, you'd know that there is no God. So, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not talking about a person that the Holy Spirit could turn around. There's a certain point where a person can reach, and I think it's very rare, but it's a point where a person can reach where God just kind of says, okay. And they just turn completely in stone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Bill.
Well, do you think maybe it might have something to do with the devil worshippers? Now, like it or not, whether we want to believe it or not, there are people that worship the devil.
Yeah.
And so wouldn't that be kind of blaspheming the Holy Spirit?
I think it certainly could. Yeah, Brian.
And that's a possibility, but we've seen people who are in the hierarchy of devil worship that have become very staunch Christians. You know, they have come into that light, and they have, and they'll tell you that for years they not only did they denounce God and hail Satan, but they did some things that are unspeakable that they can't hardly tell anybody because they would still be accountable for them. You know, there were things that were, you know, for humans to even hear about them would just immediately be abhorred at some of the things that they did. And yet, at that point, they came to the... I mean, God's grace is so magnificent that even the worst, you know, at any point, he said, whosoever, at any point, they still, until they take that last breath, they still have that opportunity.
And what you and Bill talk about, you know, Brandon, it goes back to, you know, are they so hardened, you know, that God just turns their back on them? He knows that there are those that can, you know, come back.
I think you kind of see it in Sodom and Gomorrah, where they've completely been turned over to a depraved mind. And I don't think that in the end, when they turned the pillars of salt, was an accident. You know, it's basically showing that they completely turned to a mineral, a stone, so cold-hearted that they, not that God didn't want them and didn't love them, but they became so self-centered that it didn't matter anymore, and it wasn't going to change, and they were wiped out. They were turned to pillars,
It makes me think of Skip's class a couple weeks ago when he was talking about Romans 1. In Romans 1, the last, I don't know, 6-7 verses or whatever, talks about the immorality where God let him, he just turned them loose. You know, there's no, these are my words, there's no saving them. You know, that's when, you know, it was man on man and, you know, stuff like that. He's talking about the homosexuality there. And, you know, he turned his heart off. You know, he just turned them loose, you know, into it.
And I mean, I think that their heart got turned off before his hit.
You know, right?
They completely shut themselves off from God and will never change it. And so take it as so hard-hearted. And at that point, they probably cussing them with every part of their being, you know. Mm-hmm. I think that's not the person that has gone through a hard circumstance and that fears God. That's someone that just turned themselves off completely and said, I will never accept this, and God just said, do your own thing.
Right. And I'm still thinking about the 70s.
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah, Skip.
I was thinking about, I've heard a number of peoples and even church denominations that have claimed that some of the works of the Holy Spirit, especially toward the Pentecostals, was straight from Satan, demonic. I think that's very dangerous ground to be walking. And I don't know if they committed the unpardonable sin, but any time that you attribute a move of God, if it's a legitimate move of God, to the works of Satan, I think that's the same thing the Pharisees did. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very, very dangerous. And they'd be best off to keep their mouth shut and wait and see. Well, if it's not of God, it's going to go away.
Yeah.
It's not going to, there's no fruit there. But when you start condemning anything that appears with God's hand in, I think that's scary.
Exactly. And I wondered, you know, in reading, when you look at the Pharisees, you know, and their attitude and the number of times that they have attributed Jesus's power, you know, to Satan. First of all, you know, I'm surprised, you know, that they weren't turned into a pillar of salt. I'm surprised they weren't struck dead. I've wondered, you know, that's about as close to blasphemy, I think, you know, that you could come to. But I don't know. I think one thing that might be reassuring to some people is I've heard different radio preachers say that, you know, if you have to ask yourself if you have committed the unpardonable sin, you probably haven't.
Yeah, probably true.
But we don't want that big...
Thank you.
Watch your language. You have to watch... You don't want to get into the position... You messed me up. You don't want to get yourself into the position to where you're standing before God and he's saying, I never knew you.
Yeah.
I'm like, uh-oh. Too late to take a step backwards there. But it's just like some people, you know, they have to go get saved, you know, 15 times, you know, during their life period. You know, they have to be baptized a dozen times. You know, just because they have questions, just because they have doubt. And we've talked about doubt before. And doubt is a very powerful adversary.
Well, I think he did tell these Pharisees they had committed the unpardonable sin. I think that's
just by the verbiage?
Yeah. I think over here when verse 24, when they said that he's casting out demons by Beelzebub,
mm-hmm.
I think that was the unpardonable sin. And here he's telling them, your goose is cooked, bud.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was the ultimate act of looking in the eyes of the power of God and saying with the inmost self that,
yeah,
that it doesn't matter, it's coming from somewhere else, and it's bad and not good.
Yeah.
Remember, they've been doubling down. They don't like the miracles. You know, the authority he's used, he's really stepping on their toes. They're getting tired of being called vipers, you know, by John the Baptist and by Jesus Christ. But the reason they are is because of the poison that comes out of their mouth. And not only aren't they helping themselves any, they're not helping their followers any either, you know, leading them astray. And that's just, I don't know how you could stand there or sit there and watch what he had done, watch what he was doing, and be so jealous that you would say Satan causes is where you get your power. It's only by the power of the devil, you know, that you can do that. I mean, it seems to me like you'd be damning yourself right there on the spot. Mark 3:29. But whoever, this is a backup to verse 31, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of eternal sin. So, you know, Jesus, you know, God himself is doubling down here. But, you know, that's it. And, you know, how they can give the credit of healing to Satan instead of the power of the Holy Spirit is interesting. Thank you, Brian. But another reason why the Pharisees are having this problem is because of their self-righteousness. They think they're so good, they think that they're so pure, and they just back themselves up by other laws that they've written themselves for the people to follow, that they're not capable of sin. They are the righteous group. They're just doing what they can to help the people in the tabernacle, you know, the village folk and stuff like that. But it's a very dangerous position to be in when you think that you are without sin, you're the only one that has all the answers. So, and sometimes I think that they didn't really believe. They saw what Jesus was doing. But I wonder if they really had the realization that that was through the power of God that Jesus was doing these things. Jesus brought it up in the previous chapters. But by their very own words and their very own actions, you know, they're damning themselves. But so that puts them into a unique position in that when you're that self-righteous and you consider yourself to be without sin, it's all these other people that are sinners. You know, we're here to point that out to them and help them get on the straight and narrow, that they didn't repent. At no time during any of this stuff, at no time. Now, we did have a few righteous ones, but, you know, we're talking about the Pharisees as a whole, as a group. They never repented. And if you don't repent, what can't happen? Pardon?
Can't be
cleansed. Can't be forgiven. And that takes us back up to 31 again, where every kind of sin can be forgiven except for the unpardonable sin. But if you don't repent, you can't be forgiven. Verse 33. I'm going to talk about, too bad Susie's not here, we're going to talk about some agrarian metaphors again. Make a tree good and its fruit will be good. Or make a tree bad and its fruit will be bad. For a tree is recognized by its fruit. Here is the line that the Pharisees love so much. You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word that they have spoken. That's not real appealing right there. No. For by your words, that doesn't get any better. By your words, you will be acquitted, and by your words, you will be condemned. Thank God that there's forgiveness. But you know, because the Pharisees have added into Jesus for